Hey y'all, time once again for Tomes of Terror. Got a weird one for you today. This one is Teatro Grotesco by Thomas Ligotti. Now, I'm not sure how familiar some of you are with Thomas Ligotti's work. I guess he first kind of came to prominence in the early 1980s. He gets compared to Lovecraft a lot. He gets compared to Poe a lot. And I can totally see why. He kind of has a very strange kind of cult following, I guess. And a lot of his stuff, I haven't read a lot of it. I feel like I've read some of his short stories, like in other, anthologies and stuff. I think this is the first entire book of his. This is a short story collection as well. That is his preferred medium. He has written one novella, as far as I know, but I think he generally writes short stories. So I had read some of them, like, over the years. This is the first full collection of his that I've read. Now, a lot of his stuff gets kind of termed, I guess, philosophical horror. It's very nihilistic. It's very bleak. Some of the stories in here, I don't know if you'd call them stories in the traditional sense. Some of them are just kind of these weird, nightmarish vignettes. Some of them are these weird kind of, I don't want to say it, like philosophical treatises, like sort of wrapped around a story. I don't, it's a very strange thing to describe if you haven't read any of his stuff. But like I said, he's very into philosophical stuff. He's very into, if you remember, I think I forgot to mention this, but when we did our matinee review on the first season of True Detective, a lot of people pointed out that the character that Matthew McConaughey played, Russ Cole, on that show, that a lot of the stuff that he said was taken straight from Thomas Ligotti. Particularly he had a nonfiction book called, I think it's called A Conspiracy Against the Human Race, where he kind of espoused a lot of this real dark, this dark philosophical kind of stuff. You know, he's very, like, he thinks it's unethical to have children, like to bring children into the world, because the world is decayed and horrible, that it's not fair to them. So there's a lot of that. If you're just looking for kind of like a fun horror kind of read, where it's like, it is not this, all right? I'm just saying that right now. This is a kind of deep shit, and it's gonna be shit that is definitely not for everybody. However, from what little of his that I've read, including this book, he really has this fantastic knack for kind of putting across this really horrific, like this dreamlike sort of atmosphere. Like I said, it's not scary, it's not horror in the traditional sense, but it's very much the way that a nightmare would be. You know what I mean? He's just really, really good at evoking that. It's almost kind of like some of the stories are almost David Lynchian kind of direction. It's just they're very, very hard to describe, you know, obviously because I'm having a really hard time. So this book actually came out in 2008. I think I just ended up picking this up because I'd always been wanting to read more of his stuff because, you know, if you're in the horror genre, you hear a lot about him, you know, and I hadn't really read much of his shit. So I was like, well, I probably need to rectify that. This is actually, it's several short stories. It's in kind of three sections. Now, the sections are called Derangements, Deformations, and The Damaged and the Diseased. Now, of these three, and then each story, like the Derangements has like five stories, Deformations has three stories, Damaged and the Diseased also has five stories. Of these sections, I think the first two were probably my favorite, just because I don't want to say that it was because they had a more traditional narrative structure, because in a lot of ways they didn't. But I think the first two sections went a lot longer toward this kind of pervasive sense of just bleakness and dread. There's a little bit of kind of cosmic horror in there too, where it's kind of like humans are just like a pestilence or a virus, or it's like there's no meaning to anything. Which is what I mean when I say that his writing is very nihilistic. He seems very opposed to the idea that anything has any meaning at all. And a lot of his characters are kind of these faceless people that are always kind of like wandering into these situations and are always like thinking about killing themselves and things like that, even though they never really do it. I know it sounds like super depressing and stuff, but actually the stories are actually really, really cool and like really, really evocative. Like a lot of them take place, like for example, there'd be a story where a guy would move to this town, which is not named, and there would be just something really weird about it. Like everybody, you know, there would be streets full of houses, but it looked like nobody lived in them, or there would be like a shop there that looked like it was never open. There was always like a light flickering behind there, but it's never open. And like everybody talked about it and everybody seemed to know about it, but no one ever had been in there or knew what they sold or anything like that. It's all that kind of like this weird, mysterious, just real off-putting like imagery. I mean, the first story, which I think is probably my favorite. I don't know. There was like a bunch of good ones in there. But the first story in the book, which is called Purity, is basically just about there's this boy and he lives in this neighborhood that's like adjacent to like a much shittier neighborhood where like a lot of the houses are abandoned and stuff. And he's really, really into, as pretty much most of the characters in these stories are, is really into kind of decay and darkness and ennui. And there's, you know, they're very into that kind of stuff. So he becomes fascinated by this part of town where most of the houses are abandoned. And he has a dad who's doing these scientific experiments that you don't really know. I mean, I guess you do find out kind of what they are, like down in the basement, and he's been helping out with them. But so this kid, like, he's fascinated by this abandoned house, and he ends up in this one house where this woman lives. And I can't figure out if she's a drug dealer or a prostitute. I'm assuming drug dealer. So he starts hanging out with her. And that, like, in this creepy old house where it's like all there is like a couch and a little black and white TV or whatever. And there's like all these other drug addicts just kind of hanging out in there. And so there's all that going on. And then his dad has also, like, a Jehovah's Witness type guy. They don't call him that, but, you know, it's a religious guy, like, turns up at the house and he's like, hey, come down to my basement and I'll. He's like making an experiment. And basically, he's trying to. Let me see if I can explain this. But he's trying to, like, take all of people's, what he calls kind of their delusions, you know, whether it's religion or his belief in the supernatural, and he's, like, pulling it out of their heads, and it makes this kind of, like, substance. You know what I mean? So there's all that going on. There's the kid hanging out in the dark house with the drug addicts. And then there's also, like, a child serial killer, like, walking around. And it's just kind of like this story. Oh, and also his mom and sister are always going on these vacations, but they never say where they're going. And they never, like, when they get back, they never said what they did or anything like that. So it's just, so there's always that kind of stuff. And it never, like, adds up to anything concrete. It's just kind of like this nebulous, like, sense of weirdness. It's very, very good at that. And that's why, like, when I first started reading it, you know, that first story, Purity, like, I really got into it because I really, really liked, you know, the atmosphere of it. And he uses a very, very evocative language. And it really kind of, like, puts these kind of nightmarish pictures in your head. And it's just, it's really astounding, really. So it has kind of the same effect, like I said, as Lovecraft, just in the sense that, you know, I don't mean that to sound dismissive, because it's really, in a lot of ways, it's not like Lovecraft, but in the sense that there's just unnameable forces. There's all of this stuff that's much greater than us that we can't understand. And it's controlling our lives and there's nothing we can do about it. In that sense, it's Lovecraftian. So yeah, so I think that one was my favorite. But like I said, there's a lot of really interesting ones. For some reason, there's one, the second portion of the book, which is called Deformations. There's just three stories in that. And the theme of those seems to be how pointless he finds, like, having a job or, like, you know, working at a factory or something like that. Because those three stories are all just kind of about, you know, there'll be like a guy and he works at a factory, like, making widgets, and he doesn't really know what they're for. They're the manager that they like leaves some to do something, and they get a temporary manager, and they never actually see this person. If it is a person, they just see this weird shadow, like, behind the frosted glass that doesn't actually look like a person, that kind of looks more like a swarm of insects or something like that. Just the fact of that thing, whatever it is, being in the office makes them kind of up their productivity so much that they like don't even take breaks anymore. Like they don't go to lunch anymore. Some of them don't even go home, or they just like sleep in the factory because they become obsessed with productivity and with like getting all this stuff done. It's really weird too, because I don't think, like I said, I'm sure I'd read some of his stories prior to this, but I couldn't really remember them. But when I was reading those kind of work-related ones, I guess, if you want to say it like that, it kind of reminded me of a story that I wrote a few years ago, like about a woman that goes to this company and she's not entirely sure what she's doing. And like everyone's really weird. And then like she finds all these codes like in the handbook or whatever. So it kind of reminded me of that. And then I was kind of wondering, did I read like some of these stories before? And it kind of like unconsciously influenced me. I'm not really sure. So I liked those ones too. I liked those work related ones. They were kind of like, because as bleak and existential, you know, so much existential despair and stuff like that, they're still like kind of mordantly funny, I guess you want to call it. Like there's still kind of some funny, I want to say it's like funny shit. They're not funny, but there is like a lot of real like kind of very wry humor in them. It's odd because this is maybe going to sound like way out there, but a few of his stories, particularly those ones in the middle and a few of the ones in the first section, some of his turns of phrase and this weird like surrealist, like darkly absurdist type of thing almost gave me a little bit of an Edward Gorey vibe. If you've read any, because I know people know Edward Gorey because he's an artist, but if you've read any of his little stories that he illustrated on his own, like Amphigory or anything like that, you know, like The Doubtful Guest or, you know, whatever, then you'll maybe see what I'm talking about, where he uses this kind of, I hesitate to use the word Baroque, but this kind of like that type of language to convey not only this existential dread and despair, but also this kind of like black humor a little bit. So it almost kind of gave me like a few times I even got like an Edward Gorey type of vibe. So I don't know, maybe that's like a totally out there comparison, maybe not, because I've never heard anybody else make that comparison, but it could be just me. I'm not really sure. You know, I think some of the other stories in there that I really liked, The Red Tower, which like I said, not a story per se in the sense of having a three-act structure or that type of thing. It's basically just a vignette about a factory out on this desolate landscape that essentially seemed like it kind of just put itself there, in the sense that it just sort of like slowly materialized in this place. And it makes quote unquote novelty items, but a lot of these novelty items are stuff like, it'll be like a watch or something like that, that has, or like a cameo that you open it and it's like, looks into the blackness of the universe and stuff like that. It's all that kind of stuff. So yeah, you have that. And then there was a story in there called The Clown Puppet that was basically about a guy who every now and then he would have a visitation from this clown puppet that was like a marionette. The strings would just kind of go up into nothing. Like you couldn't see where the strings were going up into. It would just go up into fog or whatever. And every time that he came, it was always something different. Like he kind of goes into, because the story is him and he's at this place and he says, oh, I'm having another visitation. And then he kind of like talks about some of the other ones, but he said it was like different every time. So it's just really strange. Like, okay, so like I said, these aren't real traditional stories in the sense that sometimes you know the characters' names, sometimes not. It pretty much, a lot of them, if not all of them, are in the first person. And most of them are just describing a guy. It's always a guy. You know, I don't think any of the main characters are women. Ending up in this place, usually it's in this weird town or in this weird job where everything is dark. Like the only illumination is just these little flickering lamps like on the wall. Everyone's weird and everyone like, you know, walks around all sallow faced. Everybody has like a bit, you know. So if that sounds like something that you would be super into, then you will probably be super into this. Like I said, I'm not sure how familiar you guys are with Thomas Ligotti, but it's like it's one of those things where you really have to kind of be in the mood for it. He's got like a massive fan base and it's very easy to see why. Like I said, you know, I don't think there's anybody writing this type of horror nowadays that I know of, but it, as I said, if you're just looking for a fun time or you're looking for something, you know, gory or scary or something like that, this is not that. This is kind of like, you know, Lovecraftian, David Lynchian. It's just very, it's just really, really hard to like put your finger on what it is, but it's really, it has this sort of quality where when you're reading through it, it just puts these little images in your head, and it's just like, and then like the more you think about it, the larger the implications are, you know what I mean? So like I said, some pretty deep shit. So I can understand if that's not everybody's cup of tea. I will say that by the time I got to the last section, there's a lot of imagery of like carnival type stuff, like the, you know, the world is a sideshow, everything's ridiculous, nothing means anything. So there's a lot of that kind of stuff in there, like decayed circus kind of imagery. So he's really likes that. The last section of it, which was mostly the last five stories, are sort of thematically linked in the sense that they're all about artists kind of coming to terms with the meaninglessness of everything. Probably the best of those, I think, was The Bungalow House, which was about the protagonist who stumbles into this art gallery. Like, he works at a library, and then like he goes to this art gallery for his lunch hour every day and talks to the lady that owns it. And one day he finds this art installation, which is basically just like a tape that's in a tape player, and he puts on the headphones and listens to it. And the thing and the stuff that the person says, like on the tape, makes him feel like someone else understands him, like understands his proclivities in life, like how he goes about things, or, you know, how his mind works or something like that. And he starts becoming obsessed with finding the guy that made this tape. And it just kind of gets weirder from there. Don't want to spoil it. It's hard to say. It's like, you know what I mean? It's kind of like, I feel like it's, you know, saying spoiler alert or something like that doesn't really apply. Because like I said, it's not like, oh, and then she was the killer all along. It's like the stories are totally not like that. They're just very, very untraditional. And so it doesn't even really matter. But, you know, so that one I really liked. I felt like the last couple stories by that time, I guess because, you know, I read the whole thing straight through over a couple of days. And by that time, I was starting to get a little bit, you know, I was kind of like, okay, that's about enough of this existentialist blingness that I could take. So I started to get a little impatient, just the last two stories. And like I said, because the last five are very thematically linked. So they were all about artists trying to find meaning and coming to the realization that there wasn't any. So that was kind of like that's kind of like an overarching theme of a lot of his stuff, I guess, but those five in particular. So I think that section was probably my least favorite. I think I liked the first two sections, those first eight stories, a lot more, just because I just liked the atmosphere that they evoked more, I guess. The last five, since they were kind of similar, so reading all of them kind of one after another, I was just kind of like, okay, I gotcha. You know what I mean? It kind of got, because he does kind of a thing where he does this weird nightmarish hypnotic kind of thing where he'll use like repeating imagery or repeating phrases and stuff like that in service of that, which is very effective, but it's effective up to a point. You know what I'm saying? As I said, this is very, very unconventional horror, but if you're looking for something a little weird, you haven't read any Thomas Ligotti, this is very much in the weird fiction genre. But if you're into that kind of thing, then this would probably be a good place to start. He's done several other short story compilations. Like I said, that's kind of his preferred medium. He doesn't like to write novels or anything. He very much likes to do short stories. So there's a lot of these, but this is just kind of the first one I picked up just because it sounded kind of cool. And I like, you know, I like theater circus type of stuff. This does have a lot of that thematic sort of stuff, like running through it, like a lot of that imagery and stuff. So that's probably why I picked that one up first. But yeah, definitely recommend if you're into weird shit. If you're not into weird shit, you're going to hate it. You'll just be like, what is this pretentious twaddle or whatever, maybe, I don't know. But yeah, it's definitely not something just for casual horror fans. This is something for, you know, kind of hardcore horror fans that are looking for something out there, something very nightmarish. So like I said, this came out 2008, Teatro Grotesco by Thomas Ligotti. And that'll do it for this Tomes of Terror, and I'll see you on the next one. Bye.